massive and intense protests against the controversial Special Anti-Robbery Squad, or SARS, unit have been going on for at least 4 weeks now in Nigeria. But tensions between the SARS unit and the Nigerian people have only boiled over from older, long-standing issues. Now it seems that these current protests are not just against the controversial unit itself, but are also a wholesale rejection of U.S. imperialism and the influence of U.S. policy that many outside of Nigeria may not even be aware of. I'm joined by Abiodun Aremu, Secretary for the Joint Action Front in Lagos, Nigeria, to talk about these issues. Thank you so much for joining me, Brother Aremu.
Yeah, it's a pleasure to join you this afternoon in U.S., almost evening in Nigeria, this issue. So, let me start by saying that what happened, though unexpected, was to expect it. Because for years, there have been neglect in terms of how the Nigerian state have related to the critical realities and aspirations of the young ones in our country. We must understand the background to some of these developments, because particularly from the 70s, with the ascendancy of the Washington consensus in terms of the global economic control of the world, Nigeria suffered the first major setback, particularly in 1978, when the then military regime of General Olusegun Obasanjo took the first jumbo loan, which conditioned the Nigerian positions on education. Because in 1978, that was the first major crisis, and that was the first major police brutality of the Nigerian youth. That crisis of 78, then known as the Alimongo, was a policy by the government to withdraw tuitions in education and commercializations of education. In fact, that was the beginning of Nigeria being re-ruled into the foreign debt enslavement the country that had to witness. And by the time we enter the generations of the 80s, the policy of structural adjustment, the IMF, and all the World Bank policies, loan policies, become prominent in the economic agenda of the successive regime. And the younger populations were actually the victims of most of those neoliberal policies that were imposed on Nigeria. So between 78 and to the 90s in particular, was a decade in which the Nigerian state came up with policies to criminalize the youth, to undermine viral unionism and academic learning. So because when you look at the generation of the 70s to 90s, they were the generations that were defined, in which youth were clearly defined on two major planks of struggle. Struggle on the basis of class differences in society and struggle on the basis of anti-imperialist agenda. So the youth were clear, you see, at that point. But you have a government policies that were banning unions, that were undermining barrack student unionism. And by the time you have social adjustment program that increased the high rate of unemployment, government also began a policy of brigandage in the campuses. And those are part of the things that set the pace for later, for what later happened by the time you have the political transition from 93 up to the present. So you have a situation in which the youth were not only being undermined in terms of independent unionism, in terms of independent organizations, but a situation whereby youth are not being criminalized and are being encouraged into thuggery, into hostage taking, and serious things that were taking place. So by the time you now have the youth of the Twitter generations who express themselves through the online media and engagement, you have a situation in which unemployment has risen to the point whereby the state was no longer responsible to anybody. So the police institutions becomes the instrument for repressing, because you have a country in which there is no central ID card system. So part of the first challenge that Nigerians have to confront, particularly the young ones, once you're out of school, is the challenge of even identifying yourself as Nigerian. So police use the opportunity to harass people on the road, because every young person has to explain his source of wealth, has to explain his source of survival, even when it's clear that the state was not in any way responsible. So the harassment of police got to a higher scale, that they are more interested in whatever anybody is doing to survive, and you become the major victims. And the degree of polarization of the masses, the degrees of want, the degrees of state irresponsibility in terms of social welfare care of people forced many Nigerians that were going outside the country. And for those who went out of the countries and find their way back, whether with some means to survive, they become the direct target of the state, in particular the police institution. So it's not by accident that the majority of the young ones today are the direct victims of police brutality. So when the latest incident happened, it occurred at a point nobody was expecting any serious reaction from the youth. It was at a point that almost the whole country is under a state of being repressed under any form of protest, because the majority of the protests carried out by labor, civil society organizations are under the threat of being suppressed by the state. So when the youth protest came, most importantly, fueled by the fact that you have a country with over 40 million unemployed youth, in which state is not in any way responsible, in which case you have a majority of you are daily targets of harassment, victimization by the police institutions in particular. It was not unexpected we can have that kind of reaction of what is called the ENSA. And it was that reaction that opened up the youth majorly to understand that the problem goes beyond the ENSA. So, and that is why you have the kind of massive uprising that occur in that 3 weeks period. So, and you already have three categories of youth already existing in the country because of the policies of the government. You have the youth who are product of the generations of the 80s and 90s, who are through ideological training, who could understand at the basis of their struggle in society to be class struggle and anti-imperialist struggle. So they are so clear about it, you see, at that level, though they are in the minority. And you are the same youth that the state, through its policies on education, repressed in their campuses from expressing their new democratic, which are repressed year in, year out at that level. So you have the second categories of youth, who are the youth who are majorly unemployed, many out of schools, but who are being groomed by politicians for toggling activities, election rigging, and some of those things. So then you have the youth that I call the future generations, who are majorly in the leadership of that uprising. They could use information technology to spread information, and they could express themselves to access resources in terms of the advantage of information technology to be able to reach out as widely as possible. So that was exactly what was at play in those 3 weeks period. So when you look at the agenda of the state in repressing that protest, the concern initially, because majority of some of those who are in the teacher generation, some of them are children of the elite and middle class. So because even the ruling class element feel so concerned about their own element being repressed in the course of that protest, that was why the state endured for that period that it endured. And that was why when the repression of October 20 came, you could see that there was a reaction, which is totally not out of even the state's own agenda in terms of how to criminalize the protest. Because majority of the future generation youth, ideological youth that were involved in all those 3 weeks protests were not those who did what happened from the 21st of October. They were majorly the same youth that are gone by the politicians that are responsible for the arson and destruction of public and private property. So you see the kind of contradictions that unfolded in that period. And that is why you have the youth of Chita generation and other youth who are genuinely in that protest beyond the entire, demanding further agenda, not only on ending the youth, on even ending oppression and bad government in the country. So that's the kind of reality that you have in Nigeria that unfolded throughout that period in October.
Yeah, and you know, I'm so glad you broke that down and exposed the class issues that have been created by what sounds to me like neoliberal policies that we have experienced here in the United States during the same period of time, ushered in during the Reagan administration in the 80s, with privatization of public services and a corresponding demonization and repression of the youth, rising unemployment in marginalized communities. These issues are connected in these very clear one-to-one comparisons for how the United States government implemented the same kind of policies here, and the way this government responded to people, mostly the youth, rising up against those policies, with what has happened in Nigeria over the same period of time. But Brother Aremu, you talked about this struggle being realized as being beyond just in SARS by the youth, and they are looking at the broader class implications. And I think a part of that struggle is manifesting itself in the way some people are responding to not only the government not providing PPE, personal protective equipment, for the people during the coronavirus pandemic, but in the way some people are responding to finding out that some in the middle and upper class are actually hoarding those supplies. What is going on around the response to the Nigerian government response to coronavirus in these protests?
Yeah, you see, I think the protest is the further exposure of the irresponsibility of the Nigerian state. And if you have looked at all this, I'm a product of generations of the 80s. And that is why when you look at Nigerians from the 80s in terms of what has been the context and focus of our struggle is clear. And you see the Nigerian youth role in the struggle against the liberation of South Africa or Southern Africa. And then you can see organizations like Youth Solidarity on South Africa and Nigeria. You see Nigerian role in the struggle for the liberation of Western Sahara. You see Nigerian role in all the anti-IMF and various protests and structural adjustment programs that took place in this period. So you can single out the Nigerian people. And by the time you have the 1999, by the time of the 1999 transition program, what became clear is that the terms of negotiating that transition was on the basis of neoliberal policy. And that's why we have looked at successive governments since 1999. They are governments that have worked contrary to the spirit and letters of the Nigerian constitution. Because the section 16 of the Nigerian constitution, of 1999 constitution, is very clear that a government shall manage the major sectors of the economy. So what it means is that the basic economy, the basic industry, the oil industry, the energy industry, are not supposed to be privatized. But contrary to the letter and spirit of that, they were privatized. And those are the things that are the root, you see, of the corrupt atrocities in Nigeria, because the questions about fighting corruption in Nigeria is non-existent. You see, they are all just propaganda, because you cannot fight corruption when the basis of looting itself is at the heart of what becomes that economy. Because privatization, the regulations are all policies that will be unknown to the spirit and letter of the Nigerian constitution. So by the time you are having the COVID experience, Nigeria was in a state that it was said to be broke. How can a Nigerian be broke and depend on another IMF loan? as at 1978, when Nigeria took the first jumbo loan, a dollar was 45 kobo as at that time. So Nigerian currency has a higher value, even when some of us were in school, it has a higher value up to 1986. It is the structural adjustment program that began that program of devaluation. So once you are arguing is that you are arguing a country who is irresponsible to social welfare, let me just give the particular instance of education. The academic staff union of Nigerian universities have been on strike since February. Up to now, they have not resolved it. Over what? Over an agreement that was signed with the government since 2009. And as of today, 25% of that agreement has not been completed. So that is the kind of situation that you have. So you have children, students out of school for the past 9 months. You have teachers without payment for the past 7 months. So that was the kind of crisis that Nigeria has and is still having. So at the time of COVID, you see, COVID only become further avenue for looting public resources because government today cannot account, you see, for some of most of those expenditures. You see, people need to get to the grassroots to understand how many Nigerians can access even the PPE, the personal protective equipment, during COVID. So people have to fend for themselves. Even in times of food support, and those are the kind of things that came up during the protest, over welfare materials that were now being seen stuck in warehouses, long after they have claimed that the lockdown is already unlocked. You see, so that is the kind of reality that you have in the country. So the country is deep-seated in economic crisis, which is imposed out of the responsibility of the state to the people. So that's exactly what is happening. So you are running a government on the basis of looting, a government that is not in any way responsible to social welfare of the people. So Nigeria is pregnant, you see, with a major struggle to redress the economy. Because the question is in Nigeria today, and that is what will be the basis of the final struggle we have in this country, that who controls the economy and for whose interest. That is the issue. Nigeria's economy was the control for public interest. That is why the refineries are not working. Because you have a government that is rooted in primitive accumulations of our natural resources, not interested in adding values to those resources. So four refineries are not working. You see, major sectors of the economy, they are not working. So everything is almost import dependent for the country to run. And you cannot continue with such a country where you already have over 40 million unemployment youth, unemployed youth. So that is the relationship that you are having currently going on. So the country is pregnant with crisis. And except that we have to resolve that on the basis of the control of our national productive sector for to turn the country around. The question about elections are not the issues in Nigeria. The question about Nigeria is what will profit Nigerians? What will profit majority of Nigerians? What are the interests of Nigerians? Because anything short of running a clear social welfare program that can address the challenge of education, the challenge of healthcare, the challenge of gainful employment, and unemployment benefit for those who have not worked, the country will continue to be in crisis. So the last uprising is just a small screen of what will happen. Because those who are talking about NSAS, you see, who are relating with the context within the country, what they are exposed to, they are deeper issues, some of them have seen, because we are talking about issue of governance. The problem in Nigeria just goes beyond governance on the basis of who to vote for. It has to be determined by who controls the economy and whose direction. And that is the challenge even for the youth today, that the struggle we have is a struggle of interest. Which class interest predominates in society? Which class welfare predominates in society? Whose interest in terms of education will the economy serve, will the politics serve? Those are the basic questions that we must all ask. so that we cannot be reduced to slavery within our own country. So that's why there is a need for a real struggle for full independence of the country. Because a country cannot be totally economically independent and you expect that country to be free. So that's the challenge that we are going through in the country.
Mm. And, you know, you asked that the question, well, you pointed out that the question for the Nigerian youth is whose interest is the control of the country benefiting? Is it benefiting the people or is it benefiting another interest? Now, of course, Nigeria is a former colony of foreign interests. So what role in these struggles do those former colonies or colonizers have in creating this situation, and what role do they have in the violent repression of these protests in the streets?
Yeah, you see, it's important because if you look at the political economy history of Nigeria, the Nigerian youth, right from the West African Student Union days, clearly what the objectives of struggle in Nigeria should be. You see, after the 40s, the objective was about decolonization and independence. You see, and the point of decolonization is not to further make us neo-colonially dependent. So to that extent, all policies arising from globalization that will not serve the common interest are policies that are inimical to the interest of Nigeria. So by the time the youth of our generation, you see, were brought into the leadership of the struggle, the issues were clear that our interest must be to defend the interest of the majority of the Nigerian people, the working people, the artisan, the poor masses. You see, that all those who we ensured that education, healthcare, gainful employment, social welfare, provisioning for everyone, and infrastructure development are key major driving force of our society. At the same time that we are not supposed to be economically dependent, whether on policies or anything. So for that still remain. And that is why for the young generation, if you look at the politics of the government in that protest, yes, the protest was carnival-like, there were music, there were dancing, there were those things that go. That is what the government wants to encourage. They don't want you to start raising questions in terms of how come Nigerian IMF loan? How come Nigerian World Bank loan? How come the students in the universities are out of school for 7-8 months? How come most of the public institutions, hospitals, have no infrastructures? Those are the questions that have to be asked now. And that is why those youth must be encouraged to put up energy now that first we have to define that we have a country. Because when you have a country that cannot guarantee basic necessity of life, it's like you don't have a country. So we cannot continue as a dependent country. Then Nigeria has a role to play in the world. Because for us, and as defined by Kwame Nkrumah, which is very clear, you see, Africa is not free, except all parts of Africa are free. Youth of our generation, you see, get into anti-imperialist struggle on the basis of that our country cannot be dependent. Youth of our generation can express solidarity with Cuba, express solidarity with Venezuela. So those are challenges the current generation must also be encouraged to understand, because we have a position on international solidarity, not international community. You see, we have a position on internationalism. Well, international community today mostly is represented by the imperialist community, which is different from spirit of internationalism, spirit of solidarity. So those are the challenges. God was also rebuild Nigeria for humanity. You see, not Nigeria under a colonial power or any global power that will undermine our sovereignty. So those are the kind of challenges. And that is why what has happened in the last 3 weeks is just an eye-opener for Nigerian youth to understand. It is not about contesting elections to want to be governor, to want to be chair of local government, to continue to run the same neoliberal policies that will undermine the interests of the majority of Nigerians and begin to serve as slaves to imperial masters.
I mean, you know, Brother Aremu, I understand the connections between what is going on in Nigeria and has for decades and what's going on here in the United States, but many of our viewers may not understand why they should care about this uprising centered around End SARS, but is really a wholesale rejection by the youth of Nigeria against imperialism and neoliberalism. So can you explain to our viewers, for someone in Washington, D.C., for someone in Baltimore, for someone in Philadelphia who is watching this interview, why should they care about what's going on in Nigeria right now?
Yeah, the U.S. government will care about Nigerian it's not Nigerian people. They are two different things. But in the same way, I understand the difference between the great American people, you see, and the sometimes racist American government. So the point clearly is that Nigeria is the biggest market in Africa for them to exploit. So in terms of even the positions of policies, like the new partnership for African development, which basically an imperial instrument, in terms of making the AU subservient, you see, to the interest of the imperialism, they will be more interested in what goes on in Nigeria. More importantly, the African command, which has been imposed on Africa. And these are things that we must popularize for people to understand the implications. Because a year after the flag independence in 1960, Britain made that first attempt for Nigeria to sign what they called the Anglo Defense Pact. It took that generation of students who moved all the way from the only university you have in Nigeria, then called University College Ibadan, to move to the National Assembly in Lagos to put a stop for Nigeria to into that path. And since then, the policy of Nigeria is very clear. Africa is the centerpiece of Nigerian foreign policy to defend not just the African continent, but the Pan-African interest. And that was why January 11, at the extraordinary OAU summit in Addis Ababa, the then late head of state made that statement that Africa has come of age, you see, for any other territory to want to colonize it. So at that time, and for Nigerian youth, for Nigerian people, it was the height of glory for Nigerian people in terms of speaking to what our interest should be locally and also internationally. So that being clearly the point. You see, for U.S. and other global powers, the interest in the Nigerian market is important. You see, that interest determines what happened in the Gulf of Guinea. That interest determines what happened in Nigeria interest in the market. And you can see clearly, even in terms of the politics in the who become the leadership of the WTO. So they are all reflected, you see, at that level. So in terms of what the U.S. interest is here, and if you look at currently the Nigerian president, you are having a president with two faces. A president who in the 80s, as a military head of state, rejected IMF and opted for counter trade. How come the same president today embraced IMF? You have a president then who could speak on the interest of the Western Sahara. In fact, he was the head of state in Nigeria when there were the declarations of international support led by Nigeria for the recognition of the Polisario Fund. What is the policy of Nigeria today on Western Sahara? Ambivalent. So it's not by accident you are the same president, otoying you see, and signed military agreement with the United States of America. So there's the strategic interest of the U.S. here, because U.S. remains a puppeteer government, a puppeteer controlling power for the puppet that you have in the country. You see, and that is the tradition that they want to sustain, which we are not going to encourage, you see, at that level. Even when you look in terms of the economic policy, Nigeria has what we call the Defense Industrial Corporation. Today, in fighting insurgency and fighting the Boko Haram, 25% of Nigerian budget is on security. Where are all those equipment and ammunition coming from? The Defense Industry Corporation in Nigeria, in Kaduna, is not producing a single thing out of that. So invariably, 25% of Nigerian income is already frittered away through capital flight because of that dependency. So why would imperial country like that not be interested? So for us, we want a Nigerian that must be able to chart a present course. And that is what to open the eyes of the young ones to. There is no reason why a country who is largest producer of oil in the world does not have a single refinery that is functioning to refine the oil. Mm. So, the situation in which you have a more of capital flight, when you are not producing anything, what do you want to showcase to the rest of the world? So it's the money that's coming that you are putting out, and that is increasing poverty in the country and almost leading the country into a state of anarchy. And that is what must be avoided. And that is what they want, to create a state of anarchy and beg for international intervention. We must not allow that. And those are the things that young ones must understand, that in this whole struggle, the struggle must be clearly defined. It must be struggle based on what our economic interest should be, what our political interest should be. We cannot run a presidential system dependent on the U.S. model. You cannot run a parliamentary system dependent on the British model. We have to define the model that we have to run. You cannot run a country where the universities are not adequately funded, yet you have legislators that are having resources much more than what you can fund the university with, when you can fund the university at that level. So the challenge is, what is more about interest? Is it education? Is it health? Is it to be able to ensure that people have free schooling? So not to just have few people in the name of running a democracy that is non-existent as far as to relate to the reality of the common people losing the resources of the country. Mm.
So, you know, Brother Aremu, we are obsessed and with our own election here in this country. So I guess people feel like they don't have a lot of bandwidth to pay attention to international issues. But when we're talking about the foreign policy that comes out of this country's government, regardless of who is at the head of this country's government, people need to make time for this issue. So how can people in the United States support the youth in Nigeria in their uprising and movement against U.S. imperialism that goes beyond the hashtag end SARS?
Yeah, I think the first way that people in the U.S., particularly since the U.S. at the head of the control of world information order or disinformation strategy, so to put it, there's a need to seek for correct information of what is actually happening in Nigeria, engage various interests to understand the concrete reality Nigeria is going through, because it's very important. And I think this exchange of information through this interview is one way to be able to understand that. Secondly, is that this struggle is international, because the liberations of Nigeria, the struggle for genuine independence of Nigeria and other African countries also have to be on the basis of solidarity and exchange of information with others, because there are lots that people are seeing on the surface that do not actually fit that concrete reality. And I think that we have a lot of Nigerian, a lot of African brothers that are also in the Pan-African world. And I think the more organizations of the people, solidarity organizations also engage Nigerians from the point of what contribution they can make to the cause of humanity will be very, very important, because solidarity should be based on the idea. Solidarity is not just a mere expression of that we solidarize with you. And I think the struggle is not just about what money that people can give, what food that can be provided, or what funfair that can be provided. That's not the struggle that we have gone through, because all the struggle that we have gone through are on the basis of a sacrifice that takes. And there's no freedom without any sacrifices. When on September 16th, at the level of Joint Action Front, we started this long-drawn struggle on the need for system change. So we have that in mind. And as I then were repressed, because for any, what happened was the first time where you see states that will allow a mass of people gathering without attempting to disperse it. So, and it was also because the issue that were raised, an issue that the state felt that they can deal with. But when you go into much more fundamental questioning of political existence, the economic questions in Nigeria, the state come out in its real phase of repressions. So that would be, so there are much more struggles that are going to go on. They are not going to be struggles that people will have time having expensive lunch or green dance party. So it is important for people to understand that the context of struggle in Nigeria now is how we have to reassert our sovereignty, how we have to reassert our independence. So once that is understood, they can understand the kind of support that Nigeria will need beyond funfair in terms of how to get it. The U.S. didn't get it on a platter of goods. Neither did any country get it on a platter of goods. The Declaration of American Independence was 1776. But it took almost 90-something years later for the Civil War in the U.S. to show clearly that the whole empty declaration of road disputes that all people are created equal. It has been shown clearly in what is being demonstrated even 300 years later that you have to struggle for it. So I don't think that the context of what has happened in Nigeria just explains any way in terms of what the support in terms of material would be. I think there are much more support in terms of solidarity, much more support in terms of ideological orientation, much more support in terms of political education, much more support in terms of bilateral, multilateral organization of organization to understand that in Nigeria, we really need a major struggle to reassert the content of our independence for Nigeria to be relevant to the rest of the global community. So that's the way I would define the kind of challenge that is expected, so that we should deepen it more, much more the same way we have bigger challenges in terms of the freedom of people all over the world. Today, we cannot be talking of struggle for Nigeria, and we are not concerned about the UN, the US blockade of Cuba, or US blockade of Venezuela, or several other countries that the US is aggressing. And that is why the election in the US is also much more important to us in terms of what the policy of the US will be against Cuba, against Venezuela, as the other people. The freedom of Nigeria is irrelevant as far as the freedom of other people are not relevant. So the younger generation must realize that the struggle is not just about Nigeria, it's also about the rest of humanity. So those are the bigger challenges. So, and for friends in the U.S., it is important to understand it, that this struggle is not going to be a tea party. It's not a struggle of poker. It's not a struggle of jollof rice. It's a struggle to really define humanity in this part of the world.
Well, as we say, in the domestic struggle against U.S. imperialism within these borders, none of us are free unless all of us are free. And that is absolutely true in regard to the global struggle against U.S. imperialism. That includes solidarity with our brothers and sisters in Nigeria, as well as Venezuela, Cuba, Colombia, Iran, and every other country in the world that is in the crosshairs of the beast that is U.S. imperialism. So I want to thank you so much, Brother
Amandla.
Amandla, thank you so much, Brother Aremu, for joining me to talk about the struggles in Nigeria and connecting them to ours here. We wish you well, and we offer you our solidarity.
Thank you for this audience. After so much effort.
And thank you for watching. This is Jacqueline Luqman with the Real News Network in the belly of the beast, Washington, D.C.